On FRCS cracking the code.
Thank you, Akshay, for that kind introduction. And I'll be sharing a little bit about what I feel are the important points for anybody who is interested in giving these examinations and you know, taking it on from there. So to begin with, what are the Royal Colleges? Basically, these are institutions that have been given a decree by the sovereign of the United Kingdom. They don't have any special rights and privileges against other colleges, but over the years they've become very famous as institutions of learning and education. And even today, these are the three colleges in the UK which govern all of ophthalmic training in the UK. And being India being a colony of the UK, we still are very much in awe of all things British. So we have a little bit of this colonial baggage to carry. But I think there are a lot of advantages to it. The oldest of these is the Royal College of Surgeons of Edinburgh. And that was established in 1505. It was actually a guild of the barber surgeons. You may know that the surgeons are actually originally were the barbers, and they used to take off little warts and incise abscesses and boils. And in 1505, they formed their own guild of barber surgeons in Edinburgh. So that gives Edinburgh the privilege of being the oldest established Royal College in ophthalmology. And so obviously Edinburgh and Scotland and Glasgow are in Scotland, which is still technically part of the United Kingdom. And the Royal College of Ophthalmologists, which is the most recent to be established, only about 30 years ago, is based in London. The Glasgow College, we'll first talk about FRCS Glasgow because probably that's the examination that most people in India are familiar with. It, like I mentioned, it's in Scotland, but it also has a dubious distinction of being the heart attack capital of Europe. Partly that's because they deep fry everything, and that's a fried Mars bar. They, you know, Mars chocolate, they wrap it in batter and deep fry it, and that's one of their local delicacies. I couldn't go beyond the first spoon. It was atrocious. But these are a few pictures of the convocation, and it's held in a very grand style with Harry Potter like gowns and a lot of pomp and pageantry. And it's a college that has multiple specialities. It's the Royal College of Physicians and Surgeons of Glasgow, but they also have faculties of podiatry, dentistry. So it's rather a large college by itself. Coming to the examination, there are three parts. The first part is the basic sciences and optics part. It's basically just an MCQ test. There's no negative marking. The second part is the clinical sciences, which again comprises of two sections, the MCQ test, which you write on another day, and the written paper, which is a separate examination, which has three questions on ophthalmology, and there's one question on general medicine, which is essentially a medical emergency. This paper is a two-hour paper, so you have roughly about half an hour per question, but the question on general medicine has to be passed independently. If you pass the three questions on ophthalmology but fail in the question on the medical emergency, you fail this section of the examination. So they give a lot of weightage to this aspect of medical emergencies, as they should. The part three is again divided into two subparts. There's the structured oral examination, which covers ophthalmic medicine, ophthalmic surgery and pathology, and general medicine and neurology. And then the second part is the clinical examination, where you have to examine patients. And that covers the anterior segment, the posterior segment, neuro-ophthalmology and ocular motility, and oculoplastic and lid disorders. I'll come to a little bit of detail in these a little later. When are you eligible? So for part one, you basically have to finish your MBBS and internship. After that, any time you can do part one. You don't have to demonstrate having trained in ophthalmology for n number of months or years to appear for part one. However, for part two, you should have at least 5 years of post-qualification, that is post-MBBS training, of which 4.5 years should be in ophthalmology. And in part three, essentially, you have to have completed parts one and two successfully. How much does it cost? That's quite an important question, because these are expensive examinations. And these are figures from last year. So if we total up the, you know, the minimum amount that you would spend giving all three parts of the FRCS Glasgow examination is roughly a little more than 2 lakh rupees. So that is some real cause for headache and concern. Something that you should be aware of before you start giving the first part and then realize that, you know, you are running out of funds to go ahead. They also are very generous. They say you have a maximum of 6 attempts for each part. But I think before that, all of us will be quite old and infirm, and we probably also would be bankrupt. So I don't think anybody would reach 6th attempt to give each part. This is the website where you get all the additional details and their guidelines, their fees, their dates of examination. So anybody who's interested should definitely access that website and go through that. Coming to the Edinburgh examination. Now this is slightly different. It's a different college, so they have different philosophies. In part A, you have basic sciences, optics, ophthalmic investigative techniques, and there is something called generic issues of medical practice, in which they cover epidemiology, audit, something we are really not exposed to in India, good medical practice, which is defined by the GMC, and medical emergencies, and basic principles of ophthalmic surgery. This is also an MCQ examination. Part B is divided into 3 parts, and this is directly, you know, a practical examination, so you don't have any theory paper here. The first section is oral examination, where you have table vivas in 4, you know, 4 tables, and in that, what is different is principles of good medical practice, where once again you have to discuss on medical audit, ethics, other aspects of actual practice. Again, something that we are woefully lacking in training in India. The OSCE section is covers anterior segment, posterior segment, neuro-ophthalmology and medicine. And these are patients that you have to examine in each of these sections. And on the third day, you have to do a clinical refraction for half an hour, in which you have to obviously check vision, you have to do retinoscopy, and you have to do a subjective refraction, duochrome test, binocular balancing, all within half an hour. And your values have to be roughly close to what the patient is wearing, and you're graded on the basis of that. Part C is a whole different ball game, which I have not yet reached, but this examination unfortunately is only available in Edinburgh. You can't do this in India or in the Middle East like other parts. This has an extended matching question, that's a theory paper. There are 8 tables of oral examinations of 20 minutes each. In one of these, you have to discuss the documents that you have already submitted before, which includes a personal surgical outcome record, in which they want to see your results of 100 cataract surgeries, 10 squint surgeries, 10 filtering and glaucoma surgeries, 3 lid surgeries. So they have a format of training, and you need to get that assessed or filled in by your institute that you trained from, and you have to submit that data and your results of that. Additionally, you should have a research report, which should have been a published report, and a formal audit. And basically, an audit means that it has to affect patient care. So there are some guidelines as to what type of audit you need to do. And then when you go for the examination, they'll discuss all of these with you, and you get graded on that as well. And there's a third part again, which is examination of patients. So it's a very exhaustive and comprehensive examination, and probably that's why I have not summoned up the courage to go ahead with it. This is the website for the Edinburgh College, so you can get more details on that. There's something called the modified Angoff technique, which is something we are not again used to in India, but it's useful to know that these examinations don't have negative marking, and they don't have a fixed pass mark for all examinations, which means that, like in India, we have, if you don't score above 50%, you fail. It's not like that. Here, the examination, each paper is graded on the basis of its difficulty. So if the examiners feel this is a difficult paper, the pass mark is lowered. And if it's an easy paper, the pass percentage, is raised. So depending on that, it's very specific to the paper that you solve. So, you have to basically exceed that cutoff for that particular paper, which is a good thing, I think. I mean, it makes it more objective. Coming to how do you prepare for these examinations, if the chairperson is okay, I'll probably overshoot the time because we have some time. So preparing for the examination in part one, the optics part, these are the basically the recommended reading, which is what I read. And I think the textbook by Elkington is really good and very, you know, it's short and it's sweet and it really covers basic optics in a very nice way. For those who want a little more depth, the textbook by A.K. Khurana is also excellent, especially the section on contact lenses, which is really in depth. With regard to basic sciences, John Ferris is an author who has written this book on MCQs, and it's really nice because it's in the form of a guide. So you have the questions and then you have detailed answers as to why the particular option is correct and why the other options are wrong. Once again, John Forrester is a very exhaustive textbook on anatomy and physiology with relation to ophthalmology. And incidentally, John Forrester was awarded the honorary FRCS at the same convocation that we attended. For part two, it's just clinical ophthalmology. So the MS or DNB syllabus is more than enough. You don't really have to go through anything more than that. This is an MCQ book by Jeffrey Lampkin, and it's very exhaustive and it's also very difficult, I would say. The examination is not as difficult as the questions in this book. So if you don't do too well while, you know, reading this book or attempting these questions, you don't have to worry. You will still do well in the examination. Strongly recommended is the Oxford Handbook of Clinical Medicine, which is a lovely, short, concise book. It's not all that short, but the section that you need to read for the examination is very short. It's the last 40 pages of this book, which is nicely, you know, it has a red margin demonstrating that it's just emergency medicine. And these are few of the clinical situations that one has to be conversant with. I would strongly recommend knowing the dosages of drugs, especially antiarrhythmics and management of status epilepticus, etc. These are important medical emergencies, and obviously something that we can encounter in clinical practice. The aim of this part of the examination is to assess the situation, ability to establish a preliminary diagnosis, etc. So one doesn't really have to go into too many details of diagnosis, differential diagnosis and management, but you should definitely get to a working diagnosis and some brief questions about the management. Coming to a few tips. In this type of examination, they have all FRCS examinations, they are very practical, they are very methodical, and they are all assess your approach to a situation. So in a sense, the theory aspect is not even tested in the theory examinations. Nobody's asking you the third most common cause of blindness in age group less than 3 years. That's not important for this examination. But if you don't answer retinoblastoma because it's life-threatening, then that's a serious infraction. So always this examination proceeds from life-threatening to vision-threatening to a cosmetic problem, which is something we probably don't think of when we are preparing for Indian examinations. In the viva and the clinical examination, the viva is basically three tables, 20 minutes each, and these are the subsections. Most of it is very clinical and case-based, so they would give you a printout, a color fundus photograph, a visual field examination or a slide that you have to start describing and talking about. Not very complicated. And if you are going off track, they will guide you and say, could you think of something along these lines? And in that situation, you have to take the hint and say, yes, sir, you're probably right, and this could be this. So always take the clues that the examiner gives you. It's a very structured examination. Like I said, there are specific questions the examiner is allowed to ask you. He can't ask you anything under the sun. And he also has a model answer key. So if you are varying from that model answer, it is to your detriment. But if you hit those keywords which are in his model answer, you will get those points. There's no scope for interpretation on the part of the examiner that you probably were thinking something else, but luckily you said this, therefore it is you don't get the marks. There's no scope for that. If you've given those words, you get the marks. Like I said, it's always in the form of a clinical situation. Generally, the question proceeds from an easy to a difficult subpart. So the first thing would be, what do you think this patient has, or what is the finding that you can see in this photograph? And once you answer that, then he'll ask you what would be the differential diagnosis, etc. So it builds on the previous answers that you give. And of course, these are the cases that you have to see, and they cover all of ophthalmology in its detail. You spend about 12 minutes at each station, so it's very rapid. It's really like a rapid fire. Two examiners are there for the clinical cases. And on an average, you may see 3 to 4 patients. But the more patients you see, the better. The examiner will stop you if he feels that you are answering well in this particular, you understand this particular clinical situation. He'll immediately move you on to the next patient and give you a chance to, answer better and answer more in a different situation. Definitely practice pays. So if you are planning to give this examination, rehearse your answers, rehearse how you would talk about these practical problems. It's always good to have a study buddy who you can discuss your answers with, and you can pretend that one of you is a patient and one of you is the examiner, and start a methodical approach of slit lamp, and even assume, for example, that this patient, suppose you're examining a patient with Fuchs endothelial dystrophy, and you start enumerating the findings that you are imagining while seeing the slit lamp. What are the advantages of these examinations? There are certain tangible benefits. If you clear the FRCS, you do not have to give the PLAB exam for going to the UK, but you can directly then register with the GMC. If you are planning to migrate to the Middle East, there is better remuneration if you have an FRCS degree. And these degrees are accepted as valid degrees in ophthalmology in Singapore and in Hong Kong. So if you are planning to leave the country in these specific areas, yes, they definitely have an advantage over an MS or DNB. If you're planning to give the ICO examination, there's a cross exemption with parts 1 and 2A. Probably a strong reason why a lot of people give the examination is that there's some joy in having accomplished something. There's a sense of achievement, and probably a lot of us are infatuated with the post-nominal initials, that is multiple degrees after our name. We don't probably have to go to the extent of this medicine scholar who has cleared all the examinations one can think of, but it does add to our sense of ego and self-perception. The disadvantages are that it is not a licensing examination, which means that if you clear this examination, it does not mean that tomorrow you can apply and get a job in the UK, or you can get a job. You still have to go through the local regulations and local regulatory body and practices. And of course, they are very expensive examinations, so that goes without saying. We run an FRCS ophthalmology refresher course in Panvel, and anybody who's interested in this examination could definitely attend this. I think it's quite valuable because we have interactive discussions and case-based discussions, and we have patients where you can hone your skills and practice. So anybody who's interested can take down those details. Our course will probably be in the month of August, and the part 3 would be in September in Hyderabad. So I wish all of you who are giving the examinations all the very best, and thank you for this opportunity. Thank you to the chief instructor for having me here.
Thank you, Devendra.